I'm going to call to order our October 7th regular town council meeting. Would you please rise and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And item number three is roll call.
Counselor Bayby?
Present.
Counselor Donovan?
Here.
Counselor Caterina?
Here.
Counselor St. Clair?
Here.
Counselor Blaze?
Here.
Counselor Hayes?
Here.
Counselor Chair Holbrook?
And I am here too. So item number four is general public comments. If you would wish to speak on this item, please rise and head to the podium. If you state your name and address, you have 3 minutes, and general public comments are for non-agenda items. And does anybody wish to speak on general public comments? And seeing none, I will close the general public comment. Item number five is the minutes for September 16th, which are not available yet for this evening, so we will have them at the next meeting. Item number six, adjustments to the agenda. There are none at this time. Item number seven is items to be signed in treasurer's warrants, which I will do later in the meeting. So it brings us on to our next item, which is order number 15-061, is a 7 p.m. public hearing and second reading on the proposed amendments to Chapter 405, the Scarborough Zoning Ordinance, to establish a small batch processing facility use and definition, performance standards, and the zoning district in which to allow these facilities. And again, this is a public hearing. Would anybody wish to speak on the, actually, I'm sorry, excuse me for one moment. I see Karen is here, and I could throw her under the bus for just a moment. If you would please come talk to us again about small batch processing facilities.
Good evening. I'm Karen Martin. I'm the Executive Director of the Scarborough Economic Development Corporation. And tonight we have before you for the second reading is an amendment to the zoning ordinance which really deals with companies that are making small batches of things, like jams and jellies, food types of uses, and also things like jewelry and other really handcrafted items. And right now the zoning ordinance really directs that type of use into the industrial zone. And working with the Long Range Planning Committee, what we discovered was there are examples of other communities that are really allowing those uses to go in some of the more traditional commercial zones. And we began to ask ourselves, are some of these uses really even more intense than perhaps a restaurant or something like that? And we really felt by looking at them and looking at some of the examples in the region that they really could be accommodated with very little impact on other uses in the zone, in some of the traditional commercial zones like B2 and B3. And that's really what this amendment does. It does, however, say very specifically, we're willing to consider allowing you in these zones, but you must meet these very strict standards with respect to odor, with respect to traffic, with respect to deliveries. All of those types of things are very much spelled out in the performance standards. So this was our way of allowing some diversity in the zones, perhaps relieving some of the demand on our industrial zones, which were very small or very low in terms of land availability in the industrial zones. But it's also, I think, and I think the Long Range Planning Committee's thought process was some of these uses would be very happy in these other zones. They're types of things that people would want to visit. Perhaps it's a small craft brewery, those types of things. So that's really what this amendment does. It establishes a definition. It establishes some conditions under which you can do these types of uses, and it limits the size of the uses. And if you have any hard questions, Dan is here.
Well, thank you so much, Karen. So again, this is the public hearing, so if anybody would like to speak on this item, please rise and head to the podium and state your name and address. And seeing none, I will close the general public hearing. And pleasure of the council.
Move approval.
Second.
And discussion. And Jean Marie.
As the representative to Long Range Planning, we did have a lot of discussions about this. We met with some owners of property, particularly down the Haggis Parkway, and they were very supportive of seeing this type of zoning in town. I know personally, we do so much in this town with farming and food, you know, to the table, whether it's farming or seafood or whatever, that to me it makes perfect sense to allow the small batch processing in the way that we plan to provide it under this new ordinance. So I will support this, and I encourage everyone else to support it.
Thank you, Jane Marie. And Bill?
I attended the session that the Scarborough Economic Development put on to sort of air this for the neighborhood, for the other people who are in this zone. It was well received. I also think that it's a very good insight into what's going on in the region. I think Greater Portland is known for its food, for its restaurants, the whole idea of farm to table is a growing trend, and this ordinance was insightful to be able to allow it to be introduced, because one of the strengths of the Haggis Parkway area is its access to the highway, and this is going to make it a very attractive opportunity for small batch processors who want to be able to get food into the hands of the suppliers and distributors to local restaurants and other food purveyors. So I will support this.
Okay.
Yeah, there's not much. I was actually going to go along the lines of Councillor Donovan, so I can't say it any better than he did. But I personally have a friend who's been trying for quite a few years to get a bakery business off the ground, and this is exactly the perfect place for it to be. And so I'm going to fully support this also.
Anybody else? All right. And I guess I would just add that I think one year one of our goals for our business growth was doing whatever it takes. And so I really appreciate some of the out-of-the-box thinking and then revisiting, you know, what we do and we don't allow in some of our areas. And I hope it's fruitful and we get lots of good businesses from it. So with that, all those in favor, and that is unanimous. Our next item is order number 15-075, is a 7 p.m. public hearing and second reading on the proposed amendments to the Chapter 1301, the General Assistance Ordinance, pursuant to Title 22 MRSA 4305. And again, this is a public hearing. Would anybody wish to speak on this item? And seeing none, I will close the public hearing. And Tom, will you please introduce this item to us?
Yes, this is the annual rite of passage, if you will. It's updating our local general assistance ordinance to comply and be consistent with the state's eligibility standards and the maximum allowed for different benefits.
Which we do not get to choose what those numbers are.
I forgot to add that. You really don't have a choice in the matter. You just must approve it.
So, again, so this is the second reading. Pleasure of the council.
So moved.
Second.
And discussion. And seeing none, all those in favor, and that is unanimous. Now on to old business. Order number 15-068 is a second reading on the proposed amendments to Chapter 601, the Town of Scarborough Traffic Ordinance, Section 25, Parking Restrictions, Section A, Parking Restrictions, Subsection 2, Higgins Beach. And again, this is second reading. If anybody wishes to speak on this item, please rise and head to the podium, state your name and address, and you have 3 minutes.
Name is Tom DeYoung, 53 Old Blue Point Road. Obviously, this isn't an old issue, or it's been brought up for years. So this is not an issue about surfers or some momentary exposed skin. It is legal in Maine for people to go topless, whether we like it or not. As in life in general, if you look at a problem, you'll find one. If you look for a problem, you'll find one. If you pass a car accident, it's hard not to look. Okay, resist the urge to look, resist the urge to reduce restrictions on the beach access. This is an issue of money and public access. Changing the parking time limit to 30 minutes makes it nearly impossible for parents to go to the beach and get for a short getaway. Parents would park, get the kids out of the car seats, a 5-minute walk to the beach with little toddlers, and then they're there for 10 or 15 minutes, and then they have to leave and go back to, in order to follow the law of 30 minutes or the proposed law. In addition, a 30-minute time would make enforcement nearly impossible. And if it's not impossible, it would be excessively expensive to the taxpayers to be able to, you know, you're hiring at least another police officer to enforce it. It's just not enforceable. And what would the benefit be? I'm not a surfer. I'm a swimmer. I purchase a parking pass. So if the street is full, I park up at the parking lot, and I'm fine with that. I don't take my clothes off on the beach or the street without a swimsuit underneath. But, you know, I'm wearing my swimsuit just as I would on the beach. There's no exposed skin beyond what is normally exposed with a swimsuit. So in general, the people that go to the beach are there to enjoy the view and the peace, and there doesn't need to be any additional restrictions on the public beach or the public access to the beach. Thank you.
Thank you. Does anybody else wish to speak on this item?
Hi there, Melissa Gates with the Surf Rider Foundation. With regard to some discussions that have been ongoing about metered parking at Higgins Beach, I just want to mention that people can and do use the free beach adjacent parking on Bayview for 1 hour short-term use that includes surfing. Trying to solve 1 hour parking violations by spending thousands of dollars on meters, hiring staff to monitor and maintain the meters, and installing meters at the currently free beach parking spaces in town for consistency would be costly and ineffective at addressing a vast majority of issues that are raised by some of the property owners. An alternative to meters that won't discriminate against financially challenged individuals and would hang on to the special value of that free beachside parking would be to use that existing video camera on Bayview Avenue for video surveillance. This would address the illegal activity that some homeowners claim to see, such as public urination, opening car doors into traffic, flagrant nudity, and those one-hour parking violations. When such a crime would be witnessed, when you have video surveillance, the offense could be reported by a simple call to police dispatch with the time the incident occurred, and then using that live recorded surveillance feed, the PD could pull up the live recorded video at the time and see if anything illegal actually occurred, taking appropriate action if so. Metered parking only addresses one-hour parking violations, and at a great expense to the town in both upfront costs as well as the loss of the very unique availability of free beachside parking. Having that beach-adjacent free parking is something many working families cherish for their short-term use of Higgins, and I hope you will fight to hang on to it. The video surveillance solution is less costly, less resource-dependent, and a far more comprehensive approach addressing a wide swath of issues, not only the one-hour parking violations. It's a smart alternative that won't require the town to purchase meters for every beach in Scarborough to maintain consistency. It's a smart alternative that won't require the town to hire a meter maid, and it's just plain smart. And I'm hopeful that the counselors here who have interests in the entire community in mind will advance this idea and reject meters. In addition, increasing the fine for one-hour parking violations from $40 to a higher amount would add teeth to the video surveillance solution to help discourage parking violations. And then you add signage alerting the public to the video surveillance feed and the new fine amount, and that would actually help people comply with the regulations, and it would also improve the etiquette at Higgins Beach. With regard to the 30-minute proposal, one-hour parking really is short-term use, and shortening that allowable parking time to 30 minutes would only exacerbate the morning noise that has been expressed as problematic for some property owners. So thanks for hearing the comments of the Surfrider Foundation.
And anybody else wish to speak? All right. And seeing none, going. Grant?
Okay, first of all, Gwyneth Chabot, Houghton Street. First of all, I'm not sure what video camera Melissa's referring to, because I believe that was removed like 3 years ago. The town video camera was removed. Anyway, Scarborough is made up of many unique neighborhoods, each with its own personality and character. And Higgins is one of these neighborhoods. And it's composed of over 300 cottages on very small lots on very narrow streets. Unlike much of Scarborough, the majority of families who live and own at Higgins have been here for generations, or for a very long time, 20, 30, 40 years. When the zoning consultants did the charrette at Higgins in June, the residents involved in the meetings stated that maintaining the character of the community was a top priority. The consultants immediately labeled Higgins as a pedestrian community, as they noticed everyone walking in the streets. People were in the streets walking, biking, skateboarding, rollerblading, playing ball, etc. Due to the 50 by 100 foot lots, the streets are our yards. And this has been the way it has been since day one. Prior to 2011, there was no parking on any street at Higgins from April 1st to October 1st. No parking had been in place since Chief Moulton started his career as a Higgins Beach bike cop, and probably way before that. The addition of 11 spaces on Bayview during the busy season has resulted in behavior issues which are unacceptable in our neighborhood and would be unacceptable in your neighborhood. Yes, we are a beach community, but so is Pine Point, Ferry, and Prout's Neck. And the other Scarborough Beach communities do not have parking adjacent to their beaches, and they do not have these behavior issues. This is not an access issue. No one has ever been denied access to Higgins Beach. It is not an anti-surfer issue. It is a behavior issue. You have received many emails describing the issues and offering solutions. We trust that you, our elected counselors, have listened and will approach our problem with an open mind and without bias. We trust that you are proud to have this unique neighborhood in Scarborough and that you want to maintain the character of this neighborhood for residents, owners, beach users, and for generations to come. Thank you.
And does anybody else wish to speak?
Hello, my name is Susan Naden. In 1948, my family built and has since owned our cottage at 17 Shipwreck Road. I was a member of the committee formed to address the issues on Bayview Avenue with Councillor St. Clair as chairman. Thank you for realizing that inappropriate behavior and unsafe conditions on Bayview Avenue need to be addressed. In 2011, the people of Higgins Beach were told that those parking spaces were necessary to provide short-term parking for many various beachgoers. The parking was established against the better judgment of residents, but since that time, the intent of those spaces has been abused and the enforcement has never been strict or adequate. Since 2011, when parking on Bayview Avenue was first legally permitted during the summer months, the neighborhood has been adversely affected. You've heard and read about this many times and from many people, but have you considered that many Higgins Beach properties have been owned by the same family for several generations, proudly passed down to children, nieces, nephews, grandchildren, great-grandchildren, and further, with history, memories, and stories also passed on? When those homes were built or first purchased, there were no parking spaces lined out on Bayview Avenue. Conditions were different then. Therefore, for an able-bodied young person who owns a business which profits from those spaces to stand at this podium and suggest to a fifth-generation cottage owner, if you don't like the conditions passed imposed on you and your family's property in 2011 by the town of Scarborough, perhaps you should move, as her poor grandmother had to do in Massachusetts. That's preposterous, selfish, and uncaring. For another person to recommend adding home insulation in this situation is ridiculous. People living on Bayview Avenue shouldn't be expected to shut their windows to keep out the excessive early morning noise or be required to put shades on their windows. Anyone visiting the beach shouldn't have to take a detour to avoid walking by naked bodies or have to walk in the middle of the road because the sidewalk is blocked with people's stuff as they are changing clothing or loading equipment. We are examining conditions and inappropriate behavior within the town's parking spaces and in the middle of the road and sidewalk. This has nothing to do with conditions on the beach or in the water. The town has an obligation to keep its roadways and sidewalks clear for passage. Our committee was told that the only possibility for making a difference this summer was to erect a sign on Bayview with suggestions for proper behavior, that any other remedies would likely take 1.5 to 2 years to enact. We know from years of trying that signs are not read or obeyed, but I did discuss some possible phrases with friends. They included, please do not urinate in the flower barrels. Please keep the sidewalks open for walking. Please obey the 1 hour limit. Please do not park in the handicapped spaces unless you qualify. Please keep your private parts covered. Please respect the neighborhood. Please obey the noise ordinance. But the best suggestion was, these parking spaces are reserved for those who are physically unable to walk to and from the town parking lot. I hope that the town officials realize that the only way to truly correct this situation is through enforcement. It's not enough to erect a sign by the side of the road. That has not worked. Whatever ordinances are adopted or solutions are proposed, please back them up and get serious about enforcement. Thank you.
Thank you. Does anybody else wish to speak on this item? And if you do want to speak, do by all means feel free to line right up at the podium.
Joan Laurie, East Grand Avenue in Scarborough, Pine Point, Scarborough. I just wanted to, I live on East Grand, which is a very busy street with a lot of parking spaces. People come and go all day long. They start early in the morning getting there. The noise, as I said in a previous meeting, is just something I've learned to live with because I'm privileged to be there. Yes, it's not adjacent to the beach as Bayview is at Higgins, but people are parking there to go to the beach. I don't see them undressing. We do have surfers. They're very respectful. It seems I don't want to dispute the previous speaker, because that may be her experience, but it does seem, you know, there are 67 parking spaces. I don't have access to all of them within eyesight, but I do walk every day, and it's just I don't see people unloading their cars, filling up East Grand Avenue. I know it's a wider street than Bayview, but a lane is a lane. I think it's a mistake to remove or limit the parking to the 30 minutes. I know there was a lot of parking early on Ocean Avenue. That parking has been eliminated. So these spaces seem really critical to the enjoyment of the rest of Scarborough getting to Higgins Beach. Thank you.
And anybody else? All right, seeing none, I will close the public hearing. And pleasure of the council.
So moved.
Second.
And discussion.
Motion?
Yes.
Please, can I make a motion?
Yep.
I would like to move approval to amend the main motion to change the 30-minute parking along Bayview Avenue to 1 hour, as noted below. one-hour parking shall be allowed from 6 a.m. to 10 p.m. in designated parking spaces on the ocean side only of Bayview Avenue from the end of the drop-off zone to Morning Street from September 16th to April 30th. The one-hour parking shall not be in effect.
Second.
And we have a first and a second. And discussion.
No, no, you guys go ahead. I'll go off. I'll follow up.
Jean Marie.
I'm fine with this. After listening to what people have to say and taking into consideration what people have been speaking about before us for the past few weeks, 1 hour does give a bit more time for those who are there to walk the beach or bring their families to the beach or whatnot. However, I will only support it given that it's strictly enforced, because I do think that's been an issue for a while. So.
Thank you, Jim Ray. And Sean?
Yeah, so one of the things that you learn being a counselor is that not only is it important to listen, but it's to recognize that this is a learning exercise. I signed on originally in agreeing to the half an hour because, to me, at least at face value, when the conversation occurred, we kind of targeted what is actually, I think at the time we called it the Piper Shore, I'm sorry, the Co-op Beach. It's really called the Scarborough Town Landing Beach, because that is a half an hour. And I think that in listening to the citizens that spoke to us, that there are different standards for different areas of town. And that this is obviously one of those unique situations as well. And as I said in the first meeting, that I would support taking this back to an hour. I agree with the citizens that say that this is an issue of enforcement. And I think that I'm going to be making a motion after this, but we need to focus on enforcement. And I think that the 1 hour is an appropriate time.
Anybody else? Discussion?
No, you guys, no.
Okay, I'll wrap up then. I think it was important to go back to the 1 hour. I think there were some really good points made. That certainly doesn't mean that I don't acknowledge that there are some issues down there. I have disagreements on what some of those issues are, but there are some issues. I think that you need an hour. Personally speaking, for myself, if I were to take my children down there for a quick picnic, I cannot walk from that parking lot. And I'm 38 years old. And you can't judge people by how you look at them sitting in a chair or walking to their car. So for me, I would need an hour to get my kids down to that beach and back up again. It takes all sorts of people that go to that beach. And I think the good thing about Higgins is that everyone there acknowledges that. The one wonderful thing that I keep hearing from both sides is that they want to be able to have access to that beach, and they're not telling people not to come there. They're just concerned about the things that go on there. So I think, I take a lot of responsibility for this. I started this whole thing in ordinance when I started a committee that I thought we were going to get some good things out of, and I still believe that we got some good things out of it. I'm sad that some of those things were not put into effect so that we could have used the information from them for this year, but that's neither here nor now at this point. So I'm hopeful that we are going to move this back to an hour, and we'll go from there.
Peter.
Yeah, I guess, I've kind of listened, and we've gotten an awful lot of emails, we've gotten an awful lot of comments. And what I would hope is, and I guess it's kind of a microcosm of our community, that our community has become very divided on many different issues. And as we've heard people speak to us, the Higgins Beach community on this issue seems to be fairly evenly divided. And what I'd really encourage is, I think Kate started a process by which there have been some suggestions where there did seem to be some common ground where the community could come together to try to make some changes. And I just really encourage that community needs to come together. I think there's some things that were suggested that might be able to be done. We've talked a little bit, and I guess we will be talking about enforcement or other things. But we really need to come together as a community. We really have these issues that are polarizing us, and just to see some of the tensions and opinions that came forward, Whether it's this issue or the school budget issue or other things, we've got to find a way as a community that we can agree to disagree civilly and work for that middle ground for solutions that work for all. And I hope with this, as we put it back to an hour, that will allow the community to come back together and work collectively to try to address some of the issues that are of concern. So thank you.
Adam?
My feeling is that we should eliminate parking altogether down there, 365 days a year, except for handicap. But that's never going to happen. I understand that. It's a behavioral issue down there. It's terrible. It's not only in the summer, it's in the middle of the winter time. One of the things that bothers me about this is that we're talking about only limiting the parking down there to 1 hour from September, well, actually from May 1st to the September 15th. And then you have the rest of the year. It's going to be the same old zoo that it is right now. However, I can't get support to do anything else other than I'll support this. But we have to have solid enforcement in order to make this happen. And if that doesn't happen, the people of Hagen's Beach are going to be right back here again, and they have every right to be back here. That's it.
Thank you, Ed. So that leaves me, and I do believe I think there's a birdie that's told me there might be another amendment coming. So given what I think is also going to get offered in the second amendment for this amendment, which is to change it back to 1 hour, I can support, especially if it goes hand in hand with what I think will happen next. But I would say just, you know, the 30 minutes came from me, and obviously that the point of that conversation was to try to have some consistency with our beach parking and some of our rules. I think as a long term, that's still something that I think we should, well, I should say I won't be here, but I would think that you might want to look at and readdress. Because again, you know, when you get to the point, you can drive down to one beach in a community and you drive down to another beach and there's different rules and different hours and different, we need some continuity between our beach parking and our beach rules. I think that's a crucial part of having good ordinances, and people by and large will try to respect those. But if you make it so complex and there's 8 signs and it's from this date to here and it's in that community on that side of town, it's a different date, and 30 minutes here and an hour over, we need to have a comprehensive look and have consistency throughout our ordinances. But with that, I'll support the 1 hour for now. So we are now voting on the amendment, not the main motion, but the amendment to change the 30 minutes to 1 hour. All those in favor of the amendment, and that is unanimous 6. Back to the main motion, and Sean Beebe.
Yeah, I'd like to move approval to amend the main motion as amended to include the word metered as noted below. In section II, 1 hour parking shall be allowed from 6 a.m. to 10 p.m. in designated metered parking spaces on the ocean side only of Bayview Avenue from the end of the drop-off zone to Morning Street from September 16th to April 30th. The 1 hour parking shall not be in effect.
So that is a first. Is there a second?
Second.
And discussion. John.
So, you know, the one thing that I think has been consistent, even with those who disagree with maybe how the council is handling it, is that this is an issue of enforcement. And even the recommendations, while we may disagree about how to enforce it, there does seem to be at least consensus that we need to focus on that. And I think that as counselors, we often look to ordinance to try to provide greater restrictions rather than focusing on the real issue at hand. And I think that the metered parking spaces does that. I will state that this was actually a very difficult decision to make, primarily because I actually view metered parking spaces really an administrative function in enforcing the ordinance, no differently than the police chief buying radar guns to enforce the speed limits that are in town. So it was a little difficult to kind of include that in the ordinance when, you know, things change. And I think that in taking into consideration everyone's comments around the issue of metered, I think that in today's technology and world, there are ways of accommodating all the nuances that a lot of citizens have kind of stressed. So there's been a there's been conversations around financially insecure people who might not be able to afford it. I think that with today's technology, you can actually offer free metered parking and simply display a parking ticket on your dashboard. So there's a way of getting around that. There's also, you know, solar-powered type of meters. So we're talking about new technology that is good for the environment as well. The bigger piece for me is really allowing the manager, and there's a the resolve later. I hope that this also includes that we look at the parking lot and making that a metered space so that we don't actually need to have the human resources necessary to run that, because right now we have a person that actually monitors the gate, and I heard through the grapevine that person was actually confronted by a disgruntled person, and the police department actually had to be called because someone didn't want to pay the $10 fee. So I think that, you know, in order to use technology today, we need to kind of look at a comprehensive approach, and I think this is a good start, and if it works, it might be something that we look at for other areas, including Heard Park.
Sean, any other discussion?
Oh, you go first.
Well, actually, Peter.
I'm sorry, Peter.
He was quicker.
I didn't see him.
And I guess where I am on the metered, I will not support it being metered at this point. We really haven't discussed it. We really haven't gotten any information about what's the cost-benefit analysis of it. You know, I think Jessica brought up a point about consistency among other areas. Are we going to put metered parking at Ferry Beach? Are we going to put metered parking at Pine Point? And frankly, I'm not sure what metered parking down there solves. It really becomes an enforcement issue. And we've already heard from the police chief when he talked to us that with the current resources that they have, it's not enforceable. So at this point in time, and we really haven't had a chance for the public, our constituents, to talk about the metered. So I would like to table that. I think one of the proposals that we might hear about later is to come, and there's no rush to do this at this point. We've got time to work on this. I would like to first understand the cost benefit, what's it going to cost, how are we going to do it, before we put it into the table tonight. So I will not support metered, inserted metered at this point.
I'm going to jump in on the conversation here, and usually I try to bring up the rear so I can let you guys have your dialogue first and then offer my thoughts. I do want to chime in a little bit, depending on if this goes into effect or not. So this is the amendment I'm talking about. It was my intention to, at that point, rule that we are somewhat substantive in our change and to rule that this would be first reading. So for what that's worth, which would place us as a second reading in our next meeting, October
21st.
Thank you, Tom. So I would just offer that was my intent to offer that ruling in a little bit. Also at that meeting, if the second piece of this particular, I can't remember where it is in our agenda item, but if you scroll down to our last item, which is the resolution, it's to authorize our town manager to provide a recommendation for meters if we were to go forward with that and to report back to us at that October 21st meeting. So obviously we still have the amendment in front of us, and unless that amendment passes, I can't make a ruling on something that doesn't exist. So. But I thought I would offer that piece to you. Discussion? Back into the discussion. So I think, Kate, you were next.
Oh, or Jean Marie, it doesn't matter. Okay, I'll go. I think just like a couple people stated when my amendment came up, there were some stipulations on how people wanted to vote with my amendment, and I would have to also agree that I have to say that I'm concerned because I don't have all the information for the metered parking. I'm happy to hear that it would go back to first reading. I don't know enough about the meter. It would be very difficult for me to vote for something that I don't know how much it's going to cost us, exactly what it's going to do. I know that when I looked at it through ordinance at Pine Point, there was, there was like 5 or 6, 7 different variations. I don't know if Jean Marie remembers this, but 7 or at least different variations of what they could do, which it is pretty amazing what some of those metered parking slots can do. And they also range with that in pricing. And I know that Higgins Beach is very different than Pine Point. And at Pine Point, we would have needed at least 2 or 3 machines to cover. We had a much wider, bigger space there, and it just economically was not something that would have made any sense down there. We wouldn't have made, wouldn't have been able to recoup our costs at all. So that's why we let it go for Pine Point. So I completely understand where Councillor Bebine's going with this, and I agree in the sense that there has got to be more enforcement down there. And quite frankly, I know numerous people have mentioned we have got to increase the fines down there. I can't imagine somebody who gets a $200 fine for parking over their limit is going to do it again. At least I would hope they wouldn't. Maybe they would. I don't know. But I would hope that they wouldn't. I just feel like there's a couple other things that we could do before taking a huge step and going this direction. But I also don't see any harm in having the town manager explore it more. So I'm a little bit, I'd kind of like to hear from other councillors also. I guess I'm a little bit torn on that piece of it, because I totally get what Councillor Bebine is trying to do. I guess because I did do that research for Pine Point, that's where my concerns start to bubble over a little bit. And like we've talked about before in ordinance, we try to take a little bite before we do the big bite. So, I'd be interested to see where everyone else feels.
Jean Marie?
Well, since you asked, Kate.
Yeah.
No, I think where this, where the chair is making the argument, and I would agree with her, this is a substantive change, and making this a first reading.
To allow.
It will give the manager time, you know, with the resolve and whatever, to get back to us with more information. I lean towards the metering, but I would like to hear more, and I plan to support metering tonight, so at least this, moving this to the next.
John?
Thank you. So I have to at least express my disagreement in the sense that I don't believe that this is a substantive change, and I have expressed to the chair that did not believe it needed to go back to first reading. I think that this is a sensitive change, and that's a very different, and the reason is, if you just compare this particular item as substantive, I asked everyone to go back to the budget deliberations in which at the second reading we had a $2 million adjustment and there was no recommendation to go back to first reading for the budget. So I don't agree with it, but I do support it because I do understand it being a sensitive issue. I don't have a problem with that approach. I actually appreciate it very much.
Ed?
I'll support the metering primarily because it's a step in the right direction as far as enforcement is concerned. And I think we all agree that in order to do anything down there to correct any problem, we need enforcement. And this is the start of it. So I'm going to support it.
John?
I forgot. I actually wanted to mention, if people go to the actual ordinance, if you look at section 22, 23, and 24, those sections before this one do directly go to the issue of how much the fines can be. I believe for a parking space, the 1 hour, it's $40. And then handicap, I think, was $120. So there's at least a mention. I don't recall the actual number. And then it's also talks about how the grievance process is if you disagree and want to fight the actual ticket. And so I think that there's things already in place, and if we want to look at changing the tickets, that's fine to me. I think $40, if that truly is the amount, that's a little bit too low for me. I thought it was actually like $80 or something. So there is at least it's already been addressed in the ordinance itself.
There obviously Anybody else? Discussion? All right, time for me to chime in. I would think on the fees, I'd be really interested, this will come a little bit later, but it does tie to this conversation. I would be interested in maybe adding in the resolve for Tom, throw you under the bus, to explore what the fee structure is in our neighboring communities and see how we compare and make a recommendation on what the fees for the tickets for parking violations are and, you know, over time and handicaps, and make sure that we're in line with our, you know, general area. But that'll come later. So on the amendment for metered spaces, when we talked about Higgins Beach before, I did, a couple years ago, I did kind of bring up the thought of meters. So certainly I'm not opposed to it. I will say, though, I look at this as a wonderful opportunity to pilot this technology. And, of course, enforcement is the bigger issue and the bigger picture here. We have for quite some time contemplated and wondered where the technology was in order to incorporate that in all of our parking lots. Of course, we pay now for somebody to man Heard Park, Ferry Beach, the Higgins Beach lot, and there's obviously a salary that goes with that. If we could pilot this, some form of this technology, you know, as Ms. Councilor Babeid mentioned, there's solar, there's, you plug in the license plate in the parking spot, I mean, that you can really, you know, the world is open with some of the technology that's out there now. I'd be very interested in piloting it there rather than having to go completely into it with all our municipal lots and going, whoa, you know, maybe that's not working as great as we thought. So I think this is an excellent opportunity to pilot that and see how it goes, and then eventually we can make the transition to utilizing this in our municipal lots and therefore have not only money but personnel that can do more with the enforcement. So again, I personally will support this. I think it's a great pilot project. I'd love to hear a little more about some of the finite details of, you know, where the funding source for this going to come. I'm assuming beach reserve account, but I'd like to hear, you know, a little more about the units and what's available and what the costs are and what we can do to maybe pilot this down there. So with that, we are on an amendment to the main motion to add metered parking spaces to the main motion. So again, this is the amendment stating metered parking. All those in favor? That is 1, 2, 3, 4, and all those opposed is 2. So now we are back to the main motion, and I will offer, I'll sit on what I want to offer. Is there any other discussion on the main motion, John Babeid?
Yeah, I just wanted to add, and really as a final comment, the success of this, and really any other changes in anything, is really the commitment by our staff to make sure that the intent, the legislative intent of our conversation is met. And I know that Tom will do a very good job at making sure that we have support from the police department, maybe community services, whoever he designates, because it really is an administrative function to determine the best practice, because we're simply executive authority or policymakers and not administrators. So I will appreciate the report that Tom will hopefully bring back to us if the resolve is passed. So I appreciate that.
And any other discussion? All right, seeing none, another one, we need a vote after, correct? We still need a vote as a first reading. So I would like to rule at this time that we have a substantive change from where we first started our discussions on parking in Bayview, and I would like to rule that this is first reading. And with that, is there any following discussion? All right. Now we are voting on the main motion as amended to reinstate parking to 1 hour and the inclusion of meters. So again, we'll now vote on the main motion. All those in favor? That is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Peter, are you a yes?
Yeah.
You're oh, okay.
Well, this is the first reading, though. It's gonna,
first reading, yeah.
Yeah.
First reading, and that is unanimous. Thank you. And so we're on to our next item. Bill, if you'd like to come back and join us from the from the audience for the next item?
I didn't even know he was gone.
He might not.
I didn't know he was gone.
Right, I got off right away.
Yeah, I didn't, he's like, he's back.
Can you sign this, please, next to where you're
Yeah.
Why don't we go ahead and take a 5-minute recess, that way the room can clear out and. So we will be back in 5.
Thank you.
And welcome back. So, on to our next item, which is order number 15-076, act on the names that were posted to the various committees and boards by the Appointments Committee at the September 16th, 2015 Town Council meeting. And would anybody like to speak on this item? And seeing none, I will close comment and pleasure of the council.
So moved.
Second.
And any discussion?
Sure. I was at that meeting, and right, yes,
mm-hmm.
I was at that meeting. there was slight confusion because I was trying to remember if it was our last one or if it was the one before. I'm sorry. There were only a couple. We only had a couple changes, but I think they were very, very clear. And we're always looking for people. I would wish that the more community members would get involved, and it's always so easy to get information either from the website or from TODI. It's a great way to understand how town government works. I think there's a lot of misconceptions out there. I'll speak for myself. When I ran for council, I had really no idea how the council actually worked. So getting on those committees, I think, is a great way for people to kind of understand what we're up against sometimes, and it's not always easy decisions that we make. So there are numerous openings, and TODI has those.
Anybody else? Do you mind?
I would like to thank anybody who volunteers for our committees. I would echo Kate's sentiments. They're very worthwhile in getting involved in town government. I know it's kind of an old saw, but don't complain unless you get involved. So please get involved, and then maybe you can get up here and complain. But anyway.
That might come back to bite you.
Yeah.
And any other discussion? Yeah, seeing none, all those in favor, and that is unanimous. So on to new business, and exciting new business, actually. Order number 15-077 is first reading and schedule a public hearing and second reading on the proposed amendments to Chapter 313A, the Town of Scarborough Property Tax Assistance Ordinance. And before we take any public comment on that, Tom, I have you give us the quick version, and then we'll have you speak upon it.
In fact, I'd really defer to Councilor Donovan as the chair of the Rules and Policies Committee, and the chief architect really is the best to speak to the ordinance.
Be happy to. Actually excited about the opportunity to advance something which I think is going to be a great benefit to the some of the senior citizens. We have a town program that provides relief to seniors of low income who are paying what is perceived as an excessive amount of property tax. It's, in a nutshell, you need to be 62 years or older. You need to have lived in town for 10 years, and you must be eligible for the state program. The state program has changed a number of times in recent years. Working on the Finance Committee the last 2 years, I noticed that it was dropping precipitously, and I didn't know why. Tom put me in touch with the Maine Municipal Association lobbyist, who is many, many years in that position, and he explained to me what the history has been of the program at the state level. And it has been modified to save some money, to restrict it to what are eligibility requirements that can be met by people in lower property tax communities, and have essentially cut our eligibility in half. When I get started on this, I spoke with both the chair and the town manager, and the emphasis was that if it's not simple, it's not going to work, that it had to be a predictable outcome, and I think this is really what our citizens deserve. An ordinance that provides that sort of relief for low-income seniors that is predictable, that it's not going to change from year to year the way the state program has changed. And it cannot be complicated. It has to be something that can be understood. In that regard, I recruited a sophisticated tax attorney by the name of Craig Friedrich. We're very lucky to have a person of this skill, lifetime tax attorney, served his time in the Treasury Department in Washington. He understood this program and was able to bring an insight that I would never have been able to achieve without that kind of experience. We worked out a process that I think is right for Scarborough. The mechanics are actually pretty simple. We started by identifying a number that almost everybody has, and that's off your 1040 of the federal adjusted gross income number. And it appears on everyone's line of everybody who files a tax return. And we use that as our benchmark. We then made the determination that based on what the state's experience had been over time, that where you were exceeding 5% of your income to pay your property taxes, you were starting to get into an area where if you are a low-income taxpayer, low-income property taxpayer, you are starting to use up too much of your income. And so we set 5% as the standard. We set a cap, two caps to the thing. So if you're over 5% of your income, you get a dollar-for-dollar credit, rebate, a check that is sent to you, up to $500. So we put a $500 limit that came from the existing program. And we tried to tamper with the existing program as little as possible so that it had some stability and people were appreciative of what the program represented. We also set a limit on the income because obviously the purpose of this is to support people who are of seniors who are of lower income. And we used $50,000 adjusted gross income as the number. The program has a cliff at $50,000, so that if you make $50,001, you wouldn't be eligible. It's something that I think we're going to look at. I would recommend we look at for a year and see whether or not a more progressive system is in order. The formula already has a progressive element to it, in that you have to pay more taxes the higher your income is to be able to still maintain eligibility. So there is some progressiveness in it. The program includes renters. The MMA people helped me to understand the enabling legislation that exists. In the enabling legislation, it is required that you not discriminate against renters. So what the new ordinance does is it identifies a percentage of your rent that is the equivalent of what you would pay in property taxes. Obviously, you pay it, goes from your pocket to the landlord, to the municipality, to the town, but a certain percentage of what you pay as a renter is perceived to be property tax. So that's the replacement figure. And we used a number that had been proposed by the state in an effort to fix their program back to a more appropriate level. The program, something I learned from the MMA lobbyist was a very large number of people do not achieve any successful application under the state program because they don't file tax returns. Their income is so low that they're not required to file tax returns. And the state's AGI calculation is so complicated that they don't want to go through the process of just filing a form with the state to achieve eligibility. So what we've done by using the simplicity of federal AGI is we have allowed for non-filers, people of very low income, to be able to submit their 1099s and W-2s. This is all going to be administered by the assessing department, and Tom and I have gone over it with the assessing department to make sure that they are comfortable with the level of complexity that they're going to be asked to administer, and they're quite comfortable with this. And they would be able to now have non-filers be able to achieve and be on the same non-discriminatory status that everybody else is. So I think that's a real plus, because the MMA lobbyist said potentially as many as half of all eligible people do not get the benefit of this at the state level simply because they do not file. And so this program, I think, has some huge advantages, and I hope that we've included a requirement that it be reported back to us after a year. It will actually take effect. The filing deadline for applications is October 15th of each year. We couldn't, because we were already accepting applications, we couldn't get it to be applicable this year. October 15th of 2016, we'll have our first real experience and then a report from assessing to tell us how can we do it better. Thank you.
Thank you, Bill, for introducing that for us. And does anybody from the audience wish to speak on this item? And seeing none, I will close public comments. And I need a motion first. So pleasure
moved.
Of the council.
So moved.
Second.
And discussion. Okay.
I just wanted to say that I wanted to thank Councillor Donovan. He actually, we met last week.
Yes.
Got our flu shots together first and provided by the town. And then met, and he was very patient with me, went through the whole thing. I have to really commend him. He didn't take no for an answer. There were some roadblocks. I had heard about some of the roadblocks. We had encountered some of them in ordinance, and we sort of just stepped back and we let it go, and he didn't. He kept pursuing it. And I have to say that to me is what makes a pretty incredible counselor. He's fighting for his town and for his people, and to me that is pretty amazing. I
am fully in support of this and will support it from the from now until the day that I leave this council. I think it's something that this town desperately needs. Our senior citizens and low income, I mean, we've lost a lot through this state. And I think Bill's plan and what he's come up with is a pretty amazing thing. So he has my complete and full support.
Thank you.
Anybody else? Ed?
I think it's a wonderful idea. I'm certainly glad to see it. I was really sad to see the other one leave about 2 or 3 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And then this new state one come in, and Bill says, well, nobody qualifies for it. Either you don't make enough, or
yeah,
it's so complicated.
Yeah.
This is great, and I want to thank Craig also for helping.
Invaluable.
Mm.
It was invaluable.
John?
I just wanted to thank Councilor Donovan. I was actually one of the co-authors of the original proposal that was passed 14 years ago. And so I think this is a nice evolution, and I do appreciate the work and the dedication that you gave to that. And I think it's really important for really everyone to understand what we are trying to do to ease some of that burden, especially when there are so many restrictions at the state level about tax rebates and the fact that you can't just give everyone a tax rebate. There's so many different guidelines. So I think you guys did a very admirable job in making sure you covered everything, including renters and other citizens within Scarborough, so I appreciate the work.
Jim Murray?
I also would like to thank Councilor Donovan and Craig for helping with this. They did a fabulous job. I've been concerned for the last couple of years because I hear constantly from elders in this community about their concerns with property tax and the fact that they used to be able to depend on the state checks that would come in at the end of the year to help pay for their fuel,
mm-hmm,
for example. And it's just not a good situation at all. So I'm very glad to see that the town of Scarborough, through Councilor Donovan and others who've worked on this, are looking to alleviate this issue. I will say, and I know I've discussed this with Councilor Donovan, I did hear from a couple of people who have disabilities, who've come into disabilities and aren't quite old enough for this program, and they are at some point would like to be included if at all possible. But I've explained to them that at this point, you know, it's a pilot, and I don't know, I'd have to, some of it has to do with enabling legislation for those of you maybe watching who were curious about that, because we do have to work within the enabling legislation of the state, if I'm correct, right, Bill?
That really is the limitation, that
yeah,
it's you're either all in or it's
right,
62
right,
and older. And so
yeah,
it would be a piece of legislation that would benefit our community, since Social Security disability insurance people would seem to be appropriate candidates for this.
Yeah. So anyway, so there's some legislation for any legislators who may be sitting out there watching us tonight. So thank you.
Anybody else?
Just one quick question. Do we have the right skills to manage this program, and is it going to require a lot of manpower, or is it going to be pretty simple and straightforward?
Well, we're very careful, and I do appreciate all the work done in drafting, keeping in mind administrative burden, or I should say administrative ease of this program. The assessor and the key staff downstairs have been involved in the formation of this, and we've had at least 2 meetings with them, and we've actually come up with application forms. I do believe it's well within their capabilities, and I certainly don't expect the need for additional staff. It will be done with existing staff.
Good. Thank you.
Anybody else? So I'll just say ditto to all the wonderful comments from before. The one thing I just might add, it was really disheartening for a long time, and as Councilor Babine mentioned, a previous councilor, I think that was you and Ronnie
mm-hmm.
and maybe
Richard.
You know, had put a lot of time and work into a senior property relief program, and that was kind of, we were cruising, you know, from the bubble of things, and we were seeing, you know, our seniors and longtime residents really getting hit hard and really being pushed out. So it was a a great concept and a great idea. I was very disheartened to see it slowly kind of come apart because of the things going on at the state. So I do just want to add that I applaud the effort that you've put into this, Councilor Donovan, and I'm very appreciative, Mr. Frederick, for all your work and effort, because this is such a vital, important part of being able to maintain a, you know, a balance within the community. So I'm more than happy to support this, and I hope that as time goes on and this goes well, that perhaps we could even maybe see that $500 number mm-hmm. come up a little bit. Since its conception, it's been $500. Certainly since I've been here, I know how much on the tax for the average house has been added on in the last 6 years, and $500 is a drop in the bucket to that number. So with that, all those in favor? And that is unanimous. Order number 15-078, act on the request to accept the new Town of Scarborough crosswalk marking policy as recommended by Transportation Committee. Is there anybody that wishes to speak on this item? And
helpful for a little quick little commentary.
Gonna,
okay.
Yeah, cue you. I was going to cue you up in just a second.
You better.
So back to, I lost my thought, sorry. Does anybody wish to speak on this item? All right, seeing none, close the comment. And Tom, please introduce this item to me, or are you going to punt it to Dan?
I'm punting all night.
Yeah.
Second of night.
Climb right up there.
And I'm going to punt to Angela Bunch. also, for the counselors who don't know her, Angela is our town engineer, and so she helped craft this with guidance from the Transportation Committee, and also be involved in administering the crosswalk policy, and also want to just provide an opportunity to introduce her, and you'll be seeing more of her as engineering transportation projects come before you in the coming months and years. So,
thank you, Dan. I guess, like Dan had said, since I've been here, I've been working with the Transportation Committee and Dan specifically on the crosswalk policy for town. Since we're seeing, obviously, a void, there has been multiple requests recently, so I've been told, through multiple departments as well. So it's trying to coordinate that and giving one clear message on what we expect, what we need to see in order to provide a safe situation, as well as take in the input from the residents to be able to provide the feedback that we need to see where those locations need to be throughout town. So as you'll see in the policy provided to you tonight for your consideration, it does spell out the process, which is an application, which would come through me as the town engineer, and to go over some basic criteria and some guidelines, which I can touch on more specifically if you want, but basically looking at whether or not it's on a state or local road, what the speed limits are on those roads, how many lanes because of the distance crossing, things like that, looking at where you'll see a higher population of pedestrians and where that need is, and how in certain situations you might need to go above and beyond with signage or the flashing lights or things like that. So it kind of spells that all out and gives people a very clear and specific path to go from I have a concern to seeing it implemented. And of course there are situations where just because you put paint on the ground doesn't mean it's a safe situation, and so kind of guiding that as well and finding maybe a better place or a more practical place to put something like that, a new crosswalk. So if you have any questions related to it, it's pretty basic. We tried to keep it simple, I think. Transportation Committee discussed this a few meetings since I've been here, some good feedback, and so we welcome any comments or questions you might have.
Thank you. Well, let's get a motion on the table.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, and was there any other questions?
No.
I didn't.
Okay. I read through it.
So just discussion then.
I read through. Oh, I'm so sorry.
Anybody?
Okay. Yeah, I read through it. I thought it was pretty clear and basic, not basic in a
in a bad way, basic in a good way. It's nice to meet you and see you, and I think it's going to be a really good thing. It's something that, like you said, it's been requested, and I know we've talked about it before, some of us amongst ourselves, so I think it's going to be a pretty valuable thing.
Anybody else? All right. I think I'd just add, it's, as it did, it came through the Transportation Committee as well, so it's been kind of vetted and kicked around in there. I think everything's, again, pretty self-explanatory. There's just some basic, you know, I think it was 250 feet between, you know, you can't have a crosswalk on top of a crosswalk, and, you know, kind of some common sense things, if you will. So thank you for your time. Welcome to Scarborough. Welcome aboard. And with that, we'll have all those in favor, and that is unanimous. So on to our next item, which is order number 15-079, act to authorize the town manager to sign a utility easement on town-owned property at the end of Down East Lane, map 45, lot 16. Does anybody wish to speak on this item? And seeing none, close comments. Pleasure of the council.
Move approval.
Second. And before we jump into discussion, you want to talk to us about it, Tom?
Sure. The town's been approached by Unitil, who has a major service line located in Eastern Road, and they have an interest to bring that line up down Eastern Lane, I believe, to service the area of Route 1 and to perhaps move beyond our borders at some point. To do so, they need an easement from the town to be able to come off and out of the right-of-way of Eastern Road and into Down East Lane, and that's what's before you. We do have representatives from Unitil here tonight if you have specific questions.
All right. Councilor Bedline.
So the easement, just to understand, is it just like underground piping, or is it, so I'm trying to read, or is it an actual transfer station that will have a building kind of facility that's in the wooded area there, or what
now,
is it?
My understanding, this will just all be underground infrastructure, a pipe, if you will.
Okay. The only other comment I have is that, and without objection, is that the draft easement incorrectly states at the bottom that we are a city of Scarborough, and that should be corrected, because I think that we'd have quite a few people upset with us if we tried to do that overnight.
Nor am I acting town manager.
Right.
Perhaps we can change that.
Oh,
that I can deal with. It was the same party that got me all upset.
I can.
All right. And any other discussion or questions? All right. All those in favor? And that is unanimous.
Thank you.
Our next item is order number 15-080, act on the request to rescind unused and unneeded bond indebtedness as noted in attached order. And do you want to go ahead and
talk about it? Yes, this matter has been taken up to the Finance Committee, and I'll certainly let them speak to it. But this list of prior projects, these are projects that have both been approved through past CIP budgets and also approved for bonding. But in these cases, we've actually not had to actually bond the full amounts that we've been authorized for one reason or another. As you'll note, these projects date back all the way to the 94-95 time frame. So some of them are very old, and I'm not sure if pressed if we could even tell you the circumstances why we didn't spend it. The good news is we didn't spend all the authorized, up to the authorized limit. And this is really an accounting matter. We've been carrying this on the books right along, and the auditors would like us just to kind of dispense with it. So this matter has the council rescinding the previously provided authority for us to bond these amounts, and we're telling you we don't need them anymore. The biggest of which, of course, is the Wentworth School. You'll notice it's second from the last. There's about almost $3.3 million in approved bonding authority. In that case, it was by the voters that was not used. The other ones are, in many cases, very, very small amounts.
$34.
Yeah.
Okay. $3. I missed the three. By $3, we came in under budget. Hey, we came in under. That's all that matters. So, before we get too far, does anybody wish to speak on this item? Okay. Close the comments. Pleasure of the council.
Move approval.
Second.
And any discussion? All right, seeing none, all those in favor, and that is unanimous.
Thank you.
On to our next item, which is order number 15-081, act on the request to set the date, time, and location of the municipal elections for Tuesday, November 3rd, 2015, appoint the warden, set the hours for voter registration, and act on appointments of elections, ballot, and clerks pursuant to Chapter 200, Article VIII. Nomination and elections, and authorize the town clerk to make any additional appointments as necessary. So, pleasure of the council.
So moved.
Second.
And any discussion?
I just want to say thank you for everyone that's running. Tough year, so really appreciate it.
And anybody else?
Nope.
All right. Great.
Just very quickly, I want to thank people who volunteer to be election workers. I was one for a number of years before I became elected and can no longer do it, but it's fun. You get an opportunity to meet your fellow citizens if you're checking voters in and just be part of the process. So thank you to all those who are well, you get paid a small stipend, but and you get really good food. But other than that,
yeah.
Thank you for putting in your time. I appreciate it.
All right. Anybody else?
Just a word. I know Cody's prepared some general information about elections in terms of absentee voting and the like, so we'll try to keep pushing that information out there so everyone's fully informed, and we are currently accepting absentee ballots.
Yes, I
believe.
All right. So, all those in favor? That is unanimous. On to our next item of the evening is Resolution 15-005, resolved to authorize the town manager to research and provide recommendations to the town council regarding metered parking at Higgins Beach. And does anybody wish to speak on this item? And seeing none, I will close comment and pleasure of the council.
So moved.
Second.
And discussion. I'm going to interject for 1 second before a discussion. I would like to just maybe offer a friendly amendment, if you will, that we also include the ticket parking violation ticket fee structure. So that would be in a form of a motion. So that would be in a form of a motion to amend it to include that.
Second.
So discussion on my amendment.
Sounds good to me.
I agree with it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So on the amendment to include tickets and discussion on that. Sorry.
Never mind.
Yeah. Okay. Any discussion on my amendment?
I had originally drawn up some potential fee schedules, so if it's okay, I'll pass those on to Tom and it that way. I mean, not in any way. I can send them to everybody, but just it was some ideas that we had passed around earlier. So.
Fantastic. All right, so on my amendment, all those in favor, and that is unanimous. So back to the main resolution. Sean.
So I'm the one that actually requested this. And the reason is, and again, this was kind of one of those tough decisions because I don't necessarily believe that this is necessary, but I think that because of it being a sensitive issue around Higgins Beach, that as much transparency as possible in the analysis that the manager does in implementing, an administrative plan should be shared. And I think that this does that and allows it to be shared with everyone and not just councils, but it will become part of the public record, his presentation as well as that information. So I do appreciate the manager doing that research for us and making that public.
Thank you, Councilor Bayline. Councilor Hayes.
Yeah, I guess the only question I have is actually just a resource issue, whether this gives enough time to do enough study, get enough detail, does the timing work to come back?
Yes, I believe it does.
Okay.
I'm probably 80% there,
okay.
Waiting on some feedback from some vendors, so I believe I will have sufficient time to produce a quality, thorough recommendation.
Okay, that was the only concern. Thank you.
And anybody else? All right. All those in favor? And that is unanimous. So, on to our next item, item number 8, non-action items. We have none at this time. Item number 9, standing and special committee and liaison reports. And I think we'll start, I think I usually start with you. I want to start on this end. I'm sorry, with Councilor Hayes.
And mine will be easy. Nothing to report since the last time. So, none of the committees have met. So.
Councilor Bay.
I went to the planning board the other night, and it was kind of uneventful, except for the very last conversation that they had. And they want to have a workshop at the end of the year with the total planning board as it sits now and the new planning board. So they want to have a workshop with the old people and the new people.
Mm, smart.
To discuss process, all that stuff. And I thought that was an outstanding idea.
Yeah.
It's probably something that a lot of committees should do. But I just wanted to bring that forward and say I think it's a good idea, and let's go with it.
Councilor St. Clair.
I don't have one. There is no ordinance committee meeting in October. I'm going to actually be out for a couple weeks. So, and then we decided that we'll obviously wait till after the elections in November to pick November's date.
And me. So Historic Preservation did meet last night, and we had a very, for a workshop, but we had a very productive conversation just around the Danish Village is archway is coming to fruition soon. So they have poured the footings here at the Memorial Park, and they're expecting moval next week.
Next week.
Oh, cool. To move it onto the park grounds. And so it's very exciting, and they will have their next regular meeting, which is the first Tuesday of the month, which will that's election day.
That's election day.
we might come back to that. I'll have to get back to you on when that next meeting will be. I do just want to note that appointments committee does need to meet one more time before now and the start of the new council, so if we could meet prior to the next meeting at 6:30 should be fine. We just have a few applicants. It might be just me and the other councilor. But the other thing I would just note is it's not really a committee assignment, but just to I did promise that eventually we could make it to looping back to talk about goals and where we were. And So we can plan on our last meeting as a seated council in November to do that as a workshop. So just to kind of have that in the back of your head, and I'll have Tom read the goals and maybe just a quick brief update on where we're at with some of those. And so that's it for committee and liaison reports for me, Councilor Caterina.
Long-range planning, we met, and I wish Dan hadn't left because I forgot to bring my sheet with me, but I know we had a long discussion over what constitutes a multi-unit, because we have in the ordinances how many units constitute a multi-unit, and the discussion revolved around, should it be determined by size and other restrictions, or do we continue to keep a number on what's allowed in multi-units? And it was a good discussion. We didn't come up with any definitive whatever, but that we'll continue with that. We did discuss the Higgins Beach zoning a little bit, just Dan was preparing us for tonight's workshop. Also, a week ago Monday, forget the date, I went to the broadband conference. It was New England broadband conference, but I sat next to a woman from Nova Scotia and a woman from Syracuse, New York. Senator King spoke, and I had a chance to chat with him briefly afterwards, which was nice. He was like, oh, yeah, Scarborough. And I said, yeah, your office is there. And he said, oh, yeah, I know. So, you know, I'm trying to keep open that, because I know Travis Kennedy is paid really well. Travis is a resident of Scarborough also. Karen and I promised that we're going to sit down in the next I'd say week and put together exactly how we want to move forward with again, you know, we've got internet in town, but quite frankly, it's terrible, particularly if you're working from home, you're trying to do video stuff, you're trying to upload, you've got 10 kids and all of their devices and whatever, and we want to see if we can fix that, both as an economic development engine, because if you notice, Sanford is jumping on that big time, which is, I think, fabulous idea and for them, since they are very depressed economically right now, but I would like to see Scarborough. We have the three-ring binder. It goes right down Route 1, and it goes down wherever else here in town, so let's tap into it and not be behind the eight ball. And that's it for me.
A rules committee met. We've already reported on the senior property tax relief program. That was reviewed, and some good suggestions and work on that by the committee. We also worked on the charitable grants allocation issue that we're responsible for. This is Peter, Jean Marie, and myself make up that committee. And we met with a senior official of the Greater Portland United Way. This is a gentleman by the name of Dan Coyne, who is a Scarborough resident, very generous, he gave of his time. And out of it came a very good suggestion to look at the 211 call records that he has access to really kind of identify where are people looking for relief in Scarborough. We think we probably have a pretty good sense that it's food, shelter, including fuel oil, and health care, including mental health. But it will be interesting to see if this is confirmed by the 211 calls, and we're going to allow that to influence our final judgment. I'm working on a draft that reflects the discussions that we've had, and we did agree to move to finance recommendations by the town manager for the 2015 allocation. So that process is moving forward. We will then follow with a set of rules probably in the next month or two. The Energy Committee met. I think we'll let the town manager talk to the Trigen project, which was reported out. Very exciting, coming to a conclusion. There was also an extensive analysis of the recycling program that we charged the Energy Committee with the responsibility of reporting back to us on what we can do. There's some very good and simple educational elements that are being talked about that I think are going to be well received. Composting still remains, I think, the elephant in the room in that this is a weight issue. Solid waste management is all done by weight. And so a successful increase in composting is the same as recycling, but it's obviously a different process. And so working on that, Deb McDonough is tireless in her effort on this. She's passionate about these sorts of issues, and she hated the pay-as-you-throw program. So you know this is in good hands, and I think we are making some progress on that.
John.
Thank you. Just to touch upon finance briefly, there is a scheduled meeting for next week. I will send out an email. I would like to still have that meeting because it probably will be the last one for this this sitting council. I have four items as follow-up. So one, Councilor Donovan has already brought up regarding the charitable gifts. And human service allocations, we need to finalize that for the manager for the current budget year. We'll also be hopefully putting forward a capital planning policy regarding capital projects. Tom, I believe we also should have on the agenda regarding bonds, and it's I think it's called excess funding. I can't remember exactly the terminology, but it's still the bond money that didn't get we bonded it, but we didn't spend it all, so we need to have a conversation about that money. And then the last is about whether or not we want to move the budget process facilitation meeting forward, and so I'm going to reach out to our counterparts on the school board side to see if they can attend that meeting and
maybe we can present something at the next meeting to move that forward. So that's finance. SEDCO, last night was their annual meeting. It was a great, great event at the Higgins Beach Inn. I think it was a record year, and they, I believe it was about 150 guests that were in attendance. Great guest speaker, the president of UNE, spoke, which was really, really exciting. And I just really wanted to congratulate Karen Martin, the executive director, as well as Kevin Freeman, the chair, and the other volunteers. It was a really, really good event, and it was nice to see the excitement about Scarborough and the great work they've done over the year and some of the projects that are coming forward for us to consider as we continue to grow. And I did want to mention, even though it's not a formal committee assignment because it's something I do on my own, but I do sit on the Cumberland County Budget Advisory Committee representing Scarborough, and just wanted you to be aware that that process has started. Generally speaking, even though it's not final, the current request is for a modest tax increase of 2.94%. A lot of that is state-driven issues regarding the state's budget and how the governor's handling county jails in particular. But I will be able to report out hopefully by next month on what that final number will be. It's much better than what we originally projected based upon some of the legislation. So interesting work.
Yes.
Thanks, Sean. And so on to our next item, which is town manager report.
Yes, a couple of quick items. I just wanted to thank the council and the town for sponsoring me for attending my annual conference. This is the International City Managers Group. Between almost 4,000 of us get together. You know, fun time when you get that many town and city managers together. But for me, it's a great time to kind of re-energize, to reconnect with some old colleagues, to understand some of the new things in the profession. And believe it or not, there are some new ideas coming forward. So I very much appreciate the opportunity just to kind of refresh and get re-energized, and hopefully I can put some of those things back to work here. As Councilor Donovan mentioned, the TriGen project is nearing completion. We are preparing some press-related materials. We really think this, this is a really important project, not just for Scarborough, but for Maine. We're kind of a pioneer in some respects. And it's lingered so long that I think some of the luster has fallen away. So we really need to bring it back to the forefront. This week they are commissioning it, which essentially means they're filling it up with fluids and testing all the systems. And so we fully expect there'll be a couple weeks of commissioning, kind of working out the details, but we'll be operational certainly by the time the council meets next.
Mm-hmm.
The Broadchurch Sewer Project, this is the grant-funded portion that the Affordable Housing Alliance helped coordinate for the Habitat Project. The sewer is in place. For those of us that travel on Broadturn, we've endured. It's not been actually that bad.
It really hasn't. They've really done a good job.
They've been very mindful of the traffic flow, so it's been manageable. But the sewer line is in place, and they're starting to do the final paving this week and into early next week. I did want to mention the Maine Supreme Judicial Court will be hearing two appeals at Scarborough High School tomorrow in the auditorium. I don't know exactly. I believe it's open to the public.
No,
you have to register.
Okay, I'm glad you corrected me.
By invitation.
Yep.
So that's a nice feather in our cap to be able to host that event, and I'm sure there'll be some press coverage to follow. And lastly, it was my pleasure to go to the MMA convention today and to represent the town along with Councilor Babine and Councilor Donovan and 26 other folks, family, friends, and colleagues, mm-hmm. to recognize Chief Thurlow as Fire Chief of the Year in Maine. And the town, for its part in supporting him, received a plaque. His was much larger and shinier, appropriately so. But it was certainly my pleasure, a very proud moment for me and for senior staff. I think there were 28 people there. And the best thing is we were able to keep it a secret. He was totally surprised.
Yeah, that is
awesome. And it's pretty hard to surprise Chief Thurlow, but we did it today. Thank you.
Fantastic. So on to council member comments. So we'll start on the other end with Councilor Babine.
Thank you. As the manager mentioned, I am attending the MMA convention. For some reason, over the last 15 years that I've served, I've never had a chance to attend it. I'm not sure if I will again, but it's an interesting venue. It's very nice, and I'm glad it's the year in which our fire chief was recognized as Fire Chief of the Year, because it was very telling when he spoke. you know, he spoke from the heart about how much, you know, our community is really a big family. And you could really, really feel that with him. And do want to say thank you to the chief and for all he's done in our town. Also want to thank the Chamber of Commerce for hosting, again, another very successful candidates night. I was not in attendance here, but, of course, I sat at home and watched dutifully and was doing all kinds of theatrics and my wife telling me to calm down and all kinds of stuff. But it was actually a very, very good, well-run. I do appreciate what Art does. Art Dillon, who is, I believe, the current chair of the chamber, and then Kevin Freeman has done a stellar job for many, many years. Again, want to congratulate SEDCO for a very successful year and a very successful evening last night. It was wonderful. It helps when you're down to the Higgins Beach Inn and you can see that beautiful sunset. I'm sorry, Black Point Inn.
Right.
And see that beautiful sunset, and it was perfect weather out. Last but not least, even though we have another meeting beforehand, it's our responsibility to get out and vote, and absentee mm-hmm. ballots are available. There's no reason why you know, we don't exercise that one God-given right that we have, and I hope that everyone gets out and votes and speaks their mind regarding, it's not a very colorful ballot, but it's local races are very important as well as the state referendum, and so I do hope everyone comes out and votes.
Thank you. Councilor Donovan.
Yeah, it was an honor to attend Chief Thurlow's award today. His remarks, as you would expect, very self-deprecating, you know, not taking any of the honors himself. We all appreciated being there. Chief Moulton gave me an update on his Operation Hope first week, and very exciting. 10 people received assistance in the first 5 days of the program, 3 from Scarborough, 7 not from Scarborough. And this is, remember, a program that only Scarborough is offering. So he was very excited about it. I ran into him at the SEDCO event last night. The enthusiasm, the growing enthusiasm for this SEDCO annual meeting is terrific. People look forward to the speakers. They look forward to the awards. They are running out of space. Tom and I had a chance in driving up on the bus to Augusta today to talk about it, and that we may be able to actually use some Ferry Beach or Camp Ketchup parking for people who would be willing to sort of coordinate their arrival. I bounced that off Karen Martin. She thought that was a terrific idea because the Black Point Inn's real restriction is parking. So there may be ways to allow this to continue to grow. Attended the dedication of the Pleasant Hill Preserve by the Scarborough Land Trust out at the old Benjamin Farm. Most all of the farming community families were present to honor the property's history. Kathy Mills and Paul Austin did a beautiful job of speaking about the history, recognizing the different families, Robinson family and other families. A beautiful plaque to honor Mr. Benjamin. It really was awfully well done. I attended the Salt Pump Climbing Gym grand opening, and that space is fabulous. You really ought to go in. It's for all ages. The ownership spoke, and they're very dynamic. They really have a vision of what this place can be, and it's amazing inside. I really would encourage people to take the opportunity. Just walk inside, and you really enjoy it.
Did you climb?
No. I'm under instructions not to leave the ground. Thank you.
Great. I also attended the SEDCO dinner last night. It was a great event. Had a chance to chat with a number of people I really see. And I appreciated all the businesses who won awards. I think we do a fabulous job in Scarborough.
and Karen Martin does a fabulous job of bringing in businesses of all types, little, large. I had a client call her in the last week. He's looking for space to expand. He's in his own garage right now, and he called me up saying, do you know any property? And I'm like, call Karen Martin. So he started talking to her. Also, the Operation Hope, as I mentioned before, I have a family member who's struggled with addiction to heroin. I just think it's amazing what they've done in the few short days that they've been doing this program. It's mind-boggling, actually, what goes on out there. But to think that the Scarborough Police, Chief Moulton last night mentioned to Bill and I that, what was it, Orange, New Jersey? Some police department in New Jersey has contacted them regarding finding out what we're doing here and why we're doing it so well.
And we do it right.
Yeah, exactly. And I want to emphasize, there's absolutely no taxpayer money involved with this. People, in case they're worried about that. And they've had some private donations come forward. It's just a very interesting program, and I'm absolutely thrilled that we're doing it here in Scarborough. And I hope we get some more press. I'm looking at on this. But anyway, that's it for me.
And Councilor St. Clair.
Two quick things. One, just about the Operation Hope that everyone else has been talking about. I think one of the great things about it, and I will say that one of my best friends is actually works for the PD and is working very closely with that program. And I think that part of the problem is that there's such a stigma, and people get sadly go down the path of drugs, and they find themselves stuck. And then a lot like mental illness and other issues, they feel like there's nowhere to turn, and they almost become embarrassed that they have a problem. And it's a disease. And as soon as people start seeing it like that, I think we'll start to have people that will go and get more help. And so I think it's pretty amazing what the PD is doing. And so I do commend them, and I do know just from speaking with her how hard these guys are working and donating a lot of their time. I know all the time that she's putting into it is all volunteer time. So I think that's pretty cool. The other thing I wanted to mention, I meant to say this when Councillor Donovan was talking about his assistance program, the property tax. I hope that he can possibly maybe go to some other towns and talk to them about the program that they've worked on. I know that there are other communities that are really struggling, and I think what he's come up with is something that should be shared, and especially because they have made it so easy to do, it's something that he could very easily go into a community and help spread that and maybe help out some people. So I know that's adding more to your schedule, but I just think it's something that should be shared with other communities.
Tom took the opportunity today. Okay. We actually made everyone wait for 2 or 3 minutes on the bus. Coming home, he introduced me to the MMA lobbyist who asked the very question, would this be something that you would be prepared to share and your experiences?
Good.
And so he's thinking very much in the same fashion.
Good. Oh, sorry.
Nope.
Good. I'm glad.
Yes.
I think that's it. Thank you.
Ed?
The only thing I want to say is that I attended the CEDCO annual meeting last night. I was absolutely amazed at the number of people that were there. And it's a great way to just go up to somebody and start a chat, a board member, a committee member. It's so easy to communicate with people in that type of an environment. And it's certainly a well-put-together event and something that CEDCO should be proud of and the town should be proud of. That's it.
Thank you, Ed. Councilor Hayes.
Yeah, I think, I'll just echo what other council members have already shared. CEDCO, was there for dinner last night, too. I just echo everybody said it. And then on Project Hope, actually know somebody that has been impacted by the program, and it was just amazing to see how appreciative they were of the different approach. So when it gets personal, when you know somebody, it just is really powerful. So I'll kind of echo that. And the last thing I just suggest, and I think was touched on earlier, that there are candidates running this year for council. Get to know them. There are some differences between them. So all those that are out there, just take some time, get to know who they are, and come to the polls, as Councilor Bavine suggested, and cast your vote. So thank you.
And last but not least, me. So, ditto, I went to the SAGCO.
Yeah.
Anyway, but I was there very only briefly because I had to leave and go to historic preservation. So I missed some of the fun stuff, but I did go. I'm really excited and very proud of Scarborough and to hear that Operation Hope is going very well. Mm-hmm. I would love to see, this program just be so successful that we don't even need it. That would be, in a perfect world, obviously. But I'm very happy and proud of our community for doing this. And mm-hmm. I'm thankful to my fellow counselors for being willing to kind of step outside of the box a little bit and look at how we can, obviously things haven't been working. So looking at a problem a little differently and thinking outside the box about how to, maybe help and fix it. So congratulations, Chief Thurlow, fantastic, wonderful, wonderful news. And it wouldn't be me if I didn't say it's that time of year, it's getting cold, and
yeah.
So we do have our fuel assistance program.
Right.
So as always, we would love to have a donation to help, with the families that we help out. And, of course, as always, Tony keeps our clink bags right in her office.
Right.
So if you'd like to pick up a clink bag, like I said, as we turn our own furnaces on, let's try to remember those that perhaps are still unable to do so. And last but not least, just one last parting thought. It is hunting season. It is now officially bow season, expanded archery. Rifle season will be right around the corner, so just do keep in mind that there are hunters possibly in the woods, and try to wear nice, bright, loud colors so that they know you're you and not a deer. So with that, item number 12 is a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
And all those in favor? And that is unanimous.